Hello everyone, I am Dr. Purushree and welcome to question paper discussion on orthodontics part 5. So today we'll be discussing removable appliances, orthopedic appliances, fixed appliances, myofunctional appliances, management of some common malocclusion and management of class 2 malocclusion. Let's start with removable appliances. Here we have a long question. Define removable orthodontic appliances, list the advantages and disadvantages, describe about the cantilever spring. So first we'll start by defining a removable orthodontic appliances. So it is an appliance that is not fixed to teeth but can be removed by the patient. And then classification of removable orthodontic appliances, there can be active or passive. Then we'll write about the advantages. Advantages being, it is more acceptable to the patient and it helps in reducing the chair time because we fabricate that in the lab, and it can also help in some growth guidance. The disadvantages are, it is dependent on the patient compliance and it is difficult to obtain two-point contact that is required for complex tooth movements. Then you can write about the cantilever system, cantilever springs. So springs are active components of removable appliances that are used for various tooth movements. Then you can write about the ideal properties of springs, or you can write about the classification of springs. Then coming to the cantilever springs, that's what is asked in the question. Finger spring, which is also called as the cantilever spring. Then we have a cranked single cantilever spring, this one here. And then the Z spring, which is also called as the double cantilever spring. So you have to explain all these three springs, the construction, that is the wire that is used, the dimensions and the design of it, in what way it is bent, and then about the action, where do you use it, indications, and about the activation, how do you activate these springs. With that you will complete the answer, and the diagrams as usual are very important. Then coming to the short essays, classify springs, what are the indications of coffin spring. So springs are the active components of removable appliances that are used for various tooth movements. Classification, based on the presence of helix, they can be simple, with helix, without helix, and then compound with a helix, or based on the presence of a loop or a helix, then you can classify based on the nature of stability. So if they are self-supported, means they are made of a thick wire, they don't need any additional support. And then there are supported springs that are made of thinner wires and they need additional support. As a short note in this topic, fixed retainers was asked. So we'll start by writing what is a fixed retainer. These are retainers that are fixed or fitted onto the teeth and they cannot be removed or reinserted by the patient. Simple definition. Then you write about the examples of fixed retainers. They can be banded canine to canine retainers, bonded lingual retainers, the most commonly used, and a band and spur retainer. The next short note is components of removable appliances. This is very simple. There are three components. Active components, that are the springs, screws and the elastics. Then we have the retentive components that help in retention of the appliance, that are clasps. And then we have the acrylic base plate that is made up of the heat cure or the cold cure acrylic. So you can also add a diagram there for the parts of the removable appliance. The next short note is advantages of Adam's clasp. So Adam's clasp as such can also come as a separate question. They've asked for the advantages, which are, it is strong, simple and easily constructed. It can be made on any tooth. It can be deciduous, permanent, partially erupted, fully erupted or any other tooth. Then it is comfortable and resistant to breakage. It requires minimal space. It can be modified in different ways. You can also be asked about the modifications of Adam's clasp as a question, so you have to learn that as well. And then there is no specialized additional instruments that are needed for construction of this clasp. You can, here again, you can add a small diagram bit depending on how much time you have, because this is a short note. So another question is Adam's clasp. You can write about who introduced it, that is C.P. Adams. The other names are Liverpool clasp or the universal clasp or a modified arrowhead clasp. Then the components of Adam's clasp, there are arrowheads, the bridge and the retentive parts. So it is normally made up of a 0.7 mm stainless steel round wire, except in canine where it is made up of 0.6 mm wire. Then you can write about the advantages and disadvantages of the Adams glass. The next short note we have is functions of base plate. So base plate basically is the acrylic component of the removable appliance. So it is used as a vehicle to carry all the removable appliance components together. It is used to anchor, it is the anchor tool for tooth movement. Then it can be made up of self-cure or a heat-cure acrylic resin. And then you can write about the steps in construction. That is, how do you make it? Self-cure and for heat-cure. Next question is Roberts retractor. So this is the diagram for the Roberts retractor. It is basically a labial bow made up of a thin gauge wire. So usually it is made up of 0.5 mm wire. And then it has the coils here of 3 mm internal diameter mesial to the canine. The indications are when there is a severe proclination of anterior teeth, usually when the overjet is more than 4 mm, that is when we use the Roberts retractor. It is the main uses for retraction of anterior teeth because it is very flexible. It can be used. Then other question is finger spring. So basically finger spring, you have to write about this single cantilever spring, the indications, which wire do you use, the diagram, and the how do you activate it. Arrowhead clasp. So the arrowhead clasp, for this answer you have to write Schwartz has introduced this, and it is also called as the Schwartz clasp. So it basically consists of two or three arrowheads. You can see it here. It looks like an arrowhead. That is why it's called as a arrowhead clasp. And it is fitted in the, these arrowheads are fitted in the interproximal areas. And then the advantage here is it is flexible and reliable. But the difficult or the disadvantage here is it is difficult to construct and it requires special pliers. That is why they modified this and made a Adams clasp, which is also called as the modified arrowhead clasp. Our next topic is orthopedic appliances. We have short notes here. First question is chin cap. So it is also called as the chin cup. What is it? It is an extraoral appliance, orthopedic appliance that covers the chin. And that's why it's called the chin cup. And it is connected to the headgear. So headgear part is the part from which we derive anchorage. And it is used to restrict the forward and downward growth of the mandible. There are two types. It is occipital pull head chin cup and the vertical pull chin cup. So this is based on the place where the headgear is connected. Next topic is fixed appliances. The short essay here is enumerate various the components of fixed orthodontic appliances. Add a note on different fixed appliance systems. So first we'll define what is a fixed orthodontic appliance. Fixed orthodontic appliances are devices or equipments that are attached to teeth, cannot be removed by the patient, and are capable of causing tooth movement. It's very simple. So you have to first write it is attached to the teeth, then it cannot be removed by the patient, and they can cause tooth movement. These are the three parts of the definition. Now coming to the question that is asked, components of fixed orthodontic appliances. We'll divide them into active components and the passive components. If possible, you can remember this flow chart. It is easier for you to remember that way, I feel. Under active components, we have the separator. So basically, active components are the components that cause some amount of tooth movement, whereas the passive components are the additional, which will support the active components. So active components, we have separators, arch wire, elastic, and springs. Separators can be metal or elastic. Then under passive components, we have brackets, bands, accessories, and the molar tube. The accessories can be lock pins, ligature wire, or modules. Going on to the next part of the question, note on different appliance systems. So the first appliance system that was given by Angle is called the E-arch. Then he gave the pin and tube appliance. So based on the pin and tube appliance, Angle made the edgewise appliance. And another appliance he made is the ribbon arch appliance. based on the edgewise appliance, Andrews modified it into pre-adjusted edgewise appliance by Lawrence Andrews, and Beggs modified the ribbon arch appliance and made the Beggs appliance. Combining these two, Kessling has given the tip edge appliance. So these are the, if you just want to write it down as a list, you can write E-arch, pin and tube, edgewise, pre-adjusted edgewise, ribbon arch, modified ribbon arch, and the tip edge appliance. Coming to the short notes, advantages of fixed appliance. So fixed appliances have precise control of tooth movement. Multiple and complex tooth movements can be done. They are less dependent on patient cooperation, and there are no retention problems here. Retention as in not after the treatment, retaining the appliance. Then the next question is, list the different archware materials. So archware, are there multiple archware materials? There are a lot of newer materials also. I have listed out the most commonly used archware material: stainless steel, cobalt chromium, precious metals, nickel titanium, beta titanium, and the composite plastics. Next question is lock pins. So in big appliances, we use the ribbon arch type of brackets, and they are manufactured to accept round wires. When to hold this round wire in position, we use the lock pins. So the lock pins can be of three types: safety lock pins, hook lock pins, and the high hat lock pins. The components of fixed orthodontic appliances has also been asked as a short note. We have discussed this. What are the ideal requirements of orthodontic archware? So these are the ideal requirements that you have to write. Another short note we have is stainless steel. So you can start by writing who developed it. It was developed accidentally by Harry Brearley in Sheffield, England. So the main components are iron, chromium, and nickel. So the carbon content is also there, and it should not exceed more than 0.2%. When the chromium content is 12 to 13%, it is called as stainless steel. So that is the main point you have to remember. And there are, it exists in three forms: ferritic, austenitic, and martensitic. Additionally, if you want, you can also write where each of these type of stainless steels are used. Then we have steps in bonding orthodontic attachments. So in direct bonding, the steps are very simple. First it is cleaning, then acid etching. It is very similar to what composite restorations that you must be doing. First we clean, then acid etch, and then we a small amount of bonding agent is squeezed onto the mesh on the back of the bracket, and then it is pressed on the tooth. After pressing it on the tooth, the excess bonding material is removed. Then we light cure it. After that, bracket is bonded in place. Next question is nitinol. So nitinol, the full form is nickel titanium naval ordnance laboratory. So this is what is the nol, nitinol. Nitinol. So nitinol was discovered in 1960s by William Buehler, a research metallurgist at Naval Ordnance Laboratory. That is why the NITI Naval Ordnance Laboratory nitinol name came. It has 55% nickel and 45% titanium. It exists in two phases, that is austenitic and martensitic. Then it undergoes phase transformation, which leads to its one main important property, that is shape memory. Whenever it changes phase from austenitic to martensitic or martensitic to austenitic, there is change in the shape. So this is called the shape memory. Another important property of nitinol is the super elasticity. Moving to the next topic, myofunctional appliances. The long essay is, classify myofunctional appliances with examples. Discuss the mode of action, indications, construction, and management of functional regulator. First, we'll define what is myofunctional appliances. It is a loose fitting or passive appliance which harness natural forces of orofacial musculature that are transmitted to teeth and alveolar bone through the medium of the appliance. This definition you have to by heart. Then classification, there are 2-3 classifications that are given by different authors. You can remember any 2 or 3 of them. I feel the one by Graver is easy. He divides it into group 1, 2, 3. So group 1 is teeth supported. These are the examples. Group 2 is teeth and tissue supported examples. And then group 3 is vestibular positioned appliances. Example is the Frankel appliance. Another classification given by Prophet, which again I feel is easy, is tooth bone passive, tooth bone active, and the tissue bone passive. Coming to the next part of question about Frankel's functional regulator, there are 2 treatment effects. That's the action of it. It serves as a template against which craniofacial muscles function. The second action is it removes the muscle forces in labial and buccal areas, providing an environment which enables skeletal growth. Then the indications, there are different types of functional regulators, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are the indications for each of them. Then you can write about the components of each. Usually there are 2 main components, acrylic components and wire components. Based on the Frankel regulator 1, 2, 3, 4, there are slightly different, which you can enlist out. Then coming to the short essay, we have classify myofunctional appliances, add a note on visual treatment objective and its importance. Name any 3 fixed functional appliances. So classification we have done in the previous question. Coming to visual treatment objective, it is an important diagnostic test that we use before giving a functional appliance. So here we see how the patient will look after the functional appliance. So how do we do it? We first ask the patient to bring their mandible forward. When the patient brings the mandible forward, if there is an improvement in profile, that is a positive indication. But if the profile does not look good, that is negative indication. That means we have to use other treatment modalities, not a functional appliance. So we can use a photograph in the with the mandible in a forward position so that we can compare and see whether it is positive or negative, and also we can use it to motivate the patient. And 3 fixed functional appliances, you can write any 3 that you remember, like power scope, forces, Jasper jumper, anything that you want. Next question is, classify functional appliances. This we have done. How is trimming of an activator done? So there are multiple steps for different types of tooth movement. You can read it from the book. You have to first write about the trimming of tooth guidance, then trimming for 3D control, how it is done. It is better if you can add the diagrams here. Then trimming for extrusion of teeth, and about the selective trimming of activator for eruption. Then trimming for sagittal control. You can write about how the acrylic should be trimmed, where the bow should be there, and what are the effects on the incisors and the teeth. Next question is, classify mouth breathers and describe the design and role of oral screen in the same. So this question I have already discussed under the topic habits. It's there in orthodontic question paper discussion part 3. The next question is classify functional appliances. So you can see this classify functional appliance has been asked as a part of almost every question in this chapter. So learn that well. Next part is describe the design of twin block appliance. So the twin block appliance is made up of 2 parts, an upper and the lower plate. These 2 together, they work to position the lower jaw forward. This frees up the locked in lower jaw. That means the lower jaw, when it is in a class 2 malocclusion, it is stuck behind the upper jaw. The twin block helps to free this lower jaw and encourages it to grow to the fullest potential. So the components of this are the labial bow, delta clasp, ball end clasps, sorry, ball end, END, base plate and occlusal inclined planes. So you have to explain the use of each of these components, where are they positioned, and you can draw the diagram also. The next question is classify myofunctional appliances. We know this. Explain the mode of action and construction byte for an activator. So the mode of action, according to Anderson and Hopple, they say the activator, it induces a musculoskeletal adaptation by introducing a new pattern of mandibular closure. That means by changing the mandible, the way the patient closes the mandible, we are creating a new pattern of closure, which causes a musculoskeletal adaptation. That means there is first stretching of the elevator muscles of mastication, then there is contraction, which leads to the myotactic reflex. So this myotactic reflex, you have to remember this word, it is important, which causes a kinetic energy. This kinetic energy, it prevents the growth of maxillary dentoalveolar process, and the movement of maxillary dentoalveolar process distally, and there is a reciprocal forward growth on the mandible. So these are the three effects of this kinetic energy that is created by the activator. In addition, it also causes a condylar adaptation by backward and upward growth. This is the mode of action. And about the construction byte, you have to write about the general considerations of the construction byte and how do you take a construction byte in different types, that is low construction byte with mandibular forward positioning. There is high construction byte with minimal mandibular forward positioning, and there is construction byte without forward mandibular positioning, and construction byte for bite opening and posterior positioning of the mandible, that is usually in the class 3 malocclusions. So you have to explain how do you take construction bite for all of these situations. Coming to short note, what are the differences between activator and functional regulator? So these are the differences. There are 11 points. Mainly you have to write that activator is a tissue, is a tooth bone appliance, and a Frankel is a tissue borne appliance. Then activator makes use of the muscle activity, whereas Frankel withholds the muscle forces. It prevents the muscle forces. Another one is another main point that you can write is the indications where they are used and how do they cause expansion. Activator expansion is brought about by use of expansion screws, whereas in Frankel it brings about expansion through the forces of the tongue. Moving to the next question, philosophy of Frankel appliance. So there are 5 points here given by Frankel. That is vestibular area of operation, sagittal correction via tooth bone maxillary anchorage. Then there is differential eruption guidance. Fourth one is periosteal pull by the buccal shields and lip pads. Fifth is the minimal maxillary basal effect. So these 5 points are the philosophy of the Frankel appliance. Next topic is management of some common malocclusion. So here in this topic, a short essay has been asked, that is etiology and management of median diastema. So first we'll write about the etiology, that are the causes for a median diastema, and management, basically there are 3 phases, that is removal of cause or the etiology, then active treatment and the retention. So when we talk about removal of cause, we'll write the etiology and how do we correct it. If it is normal developmental, it is self-correcting. If it familial incidence is there, then we have to go for appliance therapy. If it is because of parafunctional habits, we have to remove the habit. Same way, if there is a different etiologies, there are different treatments. And then coming to the active treatment, it can be done by removable appliances. Usually finger springs can be used, or a split labial bow can be used, or with a fixed appliance. Here we use a elastics or springs to close the diastema. And the third part is retention. So it is easy to treat but difficult to retain. Therefore, a long-term retention is important for such malocclusions. The last topic for today, we have management of class 2 malocclusions. So here a short essay has been asked. Headgear in management of angles class 2 malocclusion. First, we'll write what is a headgear. It is an orthodontic or orthopedic appliance. Orthopedic appliance is a more appropriate term, which deliver force intraorally or to the chin from a cranial extraoral support. Then we'll write about the components. That is the face bow or J-hooks, a force element and a head cap. You can draw the diagram also and label them. Then write about the types of headgear and the uses of the headgear. Mainly because they've asked for management of class 2 malocclusion, we'll write about the orthopedic effect of the headgear. You have to explain each of these points. How does it cause the orthopedic effect? How does it distalize the molar and correct the molar relation and causes expansion? And the practical management, that is clinically, how do you deliver the headgear? The short note in this topic, we have edge-centroid relationship. So the edge-centroid relationship is, we take the edge of the incisal edge of the lower incisor and then we mark the centroid of the upper central incisor. What is the centroid? We first draw a long axis of the upper incisor and mark the midpoint of the root along that. So that is called the centroid. So the relationship between the edge of the lower incisor and the centroid of the upper incisor is called the edge-centroid relationship. Usually, the lower incisor edge is 2 mm ahead of the upper centroid. The distance is positive whenever the lower incisor edge is ahead of the upper root centroid, and if it is behind, we call it as negative. This is about the edge-centroid relationship. The other question is class 2 division 2 malocclusion. This you all must be knowing very well. According to Angle, he says when the buccal groove of the first mandibular molar occludes distal to the mesiobuccal cusp of the maxillary first molar. So this part explains the class 2, Angle's class 2 malocclusion. What is the division 2? Means with retroclination of the maxillary central incisors. This is what differentiates division 1 from the division 2. And according to British standards classification of incisor relationship, the lower incisor edge occludes posterior to cingulum plateau of upper incisors and the lower centrals are retroclined and the overjet is minimal, but sometimes it might be increased. So this is the classification given by the British standard. So with this, we finish today's discussion. So if you have any doubts, you can leave it in the comment section. Thank you.